The next item on the order paper is a motion on stalking. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for the debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the Marshall list. The proposer will have 10 minutes to propose the amendment and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly notes with concern that for too long stalking has remained a hidden crime, which is not only insidious and terrifying but can result in psychological harm and, in the most serious of cases, murder, and calls on the Minister of Justice to examine whether the introduction of new legislation to protect and safeguard victims of stalking is needed in Northern Ireland.
I call Mrs Brenda Hale to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr Speaker, and I rise to move the motion. First, I must declare some interests as a member of the Northern Ireland Policing Board, a member on the APG on domestic violence, and I recently took part in a BBC Spotlight programme highlighting the hidden issue of stalking in Northern Ireland and its lack of legal definition and framework in which agencies can act to protect and support victims. The motion I bring before the Chamber today asks us to note with concern that stalking is a hidden crime. It is terrifying and can result in psychological harm and, in more serious cases, physical harm. I, along with my colleagues, am calling on the Minister for Justice to look into the seriousness of stalking and to conclude that legislation should be introduced to safeguard the victims of stalking in Northern Ireland. This is something I've had the anxiety of dealing with myself and have a number of constituents who are currently trying to protect themselves from stalkers. At this stage, I want to thank the Justice Minister for meeting with myself, Peter Weir and a female victim of stalking before recess, and for her taking the time to return my calls over the summer. The Minister will be well aware that I have been active in gaining as much information as possible about this issue, and I'm glad she's in the Chamber today, as I know she is committed to exploring not only the issue of stalking, but its non-status in any form of legal definition, and I look forward to hearing what she has to say later. What is stalking? Who knows? As I have said, there is no legal definition, and here in Northern Ireland, we are the only UK jurisdiction not to have one. However, it is generally accepted that it includes repeated attempts to impose unwanted communications or contacts which cause distress or fear in any reasonable person. That is what the PSNI website has to say. And the Stalking NI website describes stalking as an obsessive fixation which is powered and renewed with continuous unwanted contact attempts to their target using texts, emails, letters, social media, door calling, drive-bys, following, suddenly appearing in shops or visiting places of work. I have the permission from one of my constituents who describes it much better than I can, and I ask the Speaker for his indulgence as I read an emotive and harrowing excerpt, as I feel it is important to hear of the first-hand experience of stalking. Following my exit from a 5-month relationship, this man, unknown to me, had been gathering all my personal information, routines, and had kept intimate images which I thought were deleted. He verbally threatened to have me shot and has a known history of assault. I've been followed around my town, dual carriageways, socially to friends' houses, and places of work. He has stalked my friends, my ex-partner, my family, and was outside my daughter's school. He has disguised himself in passing my house and posed as potential clients to my work email addresses as recently as November 2015. He has sent letters, cards, emails, texts, and has tried to destroy my livelihood. He has painted a black portrait of me and slandered my work ethic on social media. The PS and I have been unable to act, and I was told unless he assaulted me, they couldn't. And in 2012, the PPS didn't prosecute. They told me to evidence everything, but this was difficult to do, as my instant reaction is to run. Every day I woke up with a feeling of dread, knowing no matter what was ahead of me, he would follow me. It was like a very heavy black cloud following me everywhere I went, only I could see it. I have to keep all doors locked at all times, and I don't answer the door unless I know who it is. I watch over my shoulder and scan everywhere I go. I park my car under CCTV cameras and keep it in well-lit areas. I have my children aware of the last 4 digits of every vehicle he drives, as I do. I get leg shakes and palpitations when I see his car, knowing he wants me dead. I have felt degraded, humiliated, intimidated, and ashamed, not knowing what's coming next or who he has showed the images to. I have nowhere left to go, and he will not stop. In 2011, there was a parliamentary inquiry for England and Wales into stalking by the Justice Union Parliamentary Group, chaired by the Right Honourable Elfyn Clwyd MP. They found that the 1997 Protection from Harassment Act was not fit for purpose for stalking offences. Two new offences of stalking were included in the Protection of Freedom Act in 2012. These two offences sit alongside the existing offences of harassment in the Protection from Harassment Act in 1997. This makes stalking a more serious crime, with the potential for 5 years in prison. We still use the 1997 PHA in Northern Ireland, and I must concur with others that the chief shortcoming of the 97 Act was its failure to name stalking in law. And indeed, the review concluded that the PHA was not an effective tool against stalking, and that too many perpetrators were falling through the justice net, and there was a need for a comprehensive reform. The Departments of Justice and Health. I'm happy to give way.
Member for giving way, and I note her very personal comments on her constituent, and we do have all have constituents who have been victims of online stalking, whether standalone or coupled with physical stalking. I note the motion describes stalking as a hidden crime, but cyber stalking can be even more veiled. Would a member agree with me that those keyboard warriors who prey on the innocent and vulnerable should equally be subject to full rigours of the law and included in any future legislation?
I thank the member for her intervention, and I will get to this later on in my speech, but I agree wholeheartedly, yes. The Departments for Justice and Health jointly introduced a Stopping Domestic and Sexual Violence Abuse Strategy in March this year. This strategy includes new government definitions for both domestic and sexual violence and abuse. Included in these definitions of violence and abuse is physical and digital stalking. I am pleased that the strategy recognises the link between the two. However, in the context of this document, they define stalking only in an intimate relationship. Stalking also happens outside intimate relationships, and therefore, work to address it in these circumstances needs to be included within the strategy. We must do more. In December 2015, the Home Office started a consultation for England and Wales on the possible introduction of a stalking protection order. This consultation ended in February 2016, and we await its imminent results. The Westminster Government has recognised the need for a review of the legislation around stalking, and I only ask that here in Northern Ireland, this Assembly does the same, and indeed ask for the legislation to be put in place, as my SDLP colleagues also ask. And I support their amendment, and I'm pleased to have their support here today and hopefully in the future in this issue. The law does currently allow for a number of offences, namely harassment, causing another to fear violence, breach of an injunction prohibiting harassment, and breach of a restraining order. But the number of convictions for offences under this order are not reflective of the problem. In 2014, no one was convicted for causing fear to another. Four were convicted for breach of an injunction prohibiting harassment, and two for the breach of a restraining order. This alone screams that it is not affording enough protection for victims or giving the police and the courts enough legislation to prosecute. I recently asked the Minister for Justice in a written question to detail the number of prosecutions for stalking under the PHA 1997 in each of the last 5 years. The Department's answer was, stalking is a colloquial term, and there is no specific events of stalking in Northern Ireland. Colloquial. If I wasn't so angry, I would have laughed. These women I've been trying to support through this deserve more. They deserve the freedom to walk down the street, to sleep without fear, to feel safe in their home, and not made to feel as though they're wasting police time and are making a nuisance of themselves. Stalkers are manipulative and cunning, and in some cases use the protection of harassment order to harass and legally stalk their victims, and I know of this happening right now. We in this chamber
Would the member agree that one of the problems in respect of obtaining a just outcome in respect of both harassment and stalking is that within, for example, our local harassment legislation, there is a defence effectively of good faith? If you didn't know that what you were doing was harassment, then you have a bona fide defence. And likewise, in the stalking provisions in England, there is the good faith defence. Does the member agree that to have effective legislation, that line of defence needs to be removed from the legislation.
I thank the member for his intervention, and yes, you're right, these people are delusional. They have no idea what they're doing, or else they do know what they're doing and they're doing it deliberately and they're using the law. They know the law so well now, they're using the law to attack their victims. So I thank you very much for your intervention. So we in this chamber must put in place a framework which enables the justice system and the PSNI to protect victims, prosecute perpetrators, thus empowering their victims and their support networks. So I not only call on the Minister, but I plead on behalf of the targets of stalking that she directs her department to develop a legal framework. A legal definition will enable us not only to protect victims, but also to monitor reports of stalking, arrests and consequent prosecutions. I want to thank all those who have taken the time to join me in the Chamber today, and I look forward to hearing what they have to say and working with them in the coming months on this harrowing issue. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I call Ms. Claire Hannah to move the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I commend the member for bringing forward this important issue, and I want to assure her that our amendment is purely for the purposes of strengthening it and allowing this Assembly to be more directive as regards the legislation that's going to be needed on this. As you say, there is no formal legal definition of stalking. Most experts agree that it's a long-term pattern of unwanted, persistent and intrusive behaviour directed by one person to another that engenders fear and distress in the victim. And the impact on the victim, we feel, which may vary, should be at the centre of the legislation. There are behaviours that maybe third hand might not fall into any other legal category, but taken over time and compounded can be a huge intrusion and have a terrifying impact on the victim. Indeed, while some of the behaviours that constitute harassment will be similar to those manifesting in stalking, a key difference is the obsessive fixation, usually on one person, although we are aware of career stalkers who move on from one woman to another. And Mrs. Hale has painted a very vivid and terrifying picture of how that can feel for the victim, usually women. Stalking, of course, can be done by strangers or in the context of an ongoing domestic violence relationship. I understand that in around half of cases, it's taking place where there's only a very casual acquaintance between the perpetrator and their victim. Almost by definition, stalkers are delusional and obsessive, and in many cases go to very extreme lengths to contact and follow and monitor their victims. And we can see that in very many cases, the motivation is what they see as revenge for a woman who they believe has rejected their advances. And I think it is this societal underlying problem, this sense of entitlement by some men to the attention of women, is something that fundamentally needs to be addressed and is something that is feeding that kind of control. There have been some terrifying stories reported around the world of the indeed fatal consequences of this sense of entitlement by hopefully a very small minority of men. We obviously don't have statistics for here, but the crime survey for England and Wales suggests that 1 in 5 women and 1 in 10 men will experience the manifestations of stalking at some point in their lifetime. While, as members have said, it is a specific criminal offence in England, Scotland and Wales, there is no legislation here. In an answer to a written question earlier this year, the then Justice Minister David Ford did suggest that his department was planning to undertake a review of aspects of the criminal law, and that legislation might be brought forward in the next mandate, and we're calling through this amendment for that piece of work to be completed and for specific legislation to be developed beyond harassment, which simply doesn't encompass the full and terrifying nature of stalking. The Protection from Harassment Order 1997 refers to harassment or stalking as being a course of conduct which causes distress, alarm or fear of violence. And March 2016, a Stopping Domestic Violence and Sexual Violence strategy does specifically refer to stalking, but there is no legislative outworking, and this is only in the context of intimate relationships and therefore wouldn't address the half of cases that don't appear to be covered by that. Mrs. Dobson also touched on the issue of cyberstalking, and with all the benefits of new media and social media, unfortunately it is a tool of control for those who have unprecedented access into the daily lives of women that they choose to to stalk. And while it is mentioned in the Stopping Domestic and Sexual Violence Strategy, again, there is no legislative outworking and none at all outside of intimate relationships. There is a useful legislative format available. The Criminal Justice and Licensing Scotland Act of 2010 provides a specific criminal offence of stalking, and Section 39 of that lists a set of behaviour, and crucially has a catch-all, acting in any other way that a reasonable person would expect to cause the victim. So a lot of the very, what would appear minor and mundane actions that can have a terrifying effect. In England and Wales, stalking was made a criminal act in November 2012, and two new offences were introduced then, and the police have statistics for 93,000 harassment offences and 3,100 stalking offences, of which 1,000 plus are being prosecuted. So basically, and there you can face up to 5 years in jail, whereas here the maximum is 2 years for harassment. So we support the motion, but we do want a specific outcome for it and a commitment to bring forward legislation. Thank you.
Paul Declan Kearney, Éireamh Declan Kearney.
Gormaigara Yaskan Kurya. Treslium Maltory Natarskian Asha Agas Mullum and Lyasu at Korha Kunkin. My party welcomes this debate, and I speak in support of the amendment, as the amendment builds on the trajectory of the intent of this motion, which I fully commend. There are recognised links between domestic and sexual violence and abuse and stalking, as has been alluded to by the previous speakers. Definitions of domestic and sexual violence and abuse have been set out previously in March of this year by the Joint Departmental 7-Year Strategy. However, while those acknowledged that stalking in its physical and digital forms is a type of domestic and sexual violence and abuse. Despite that, as already mentioned by previous speakers, we still don't have a legal definition of stalking or any effective legislation here in the six counties. And this fact has been discussed by the Assembly since 2012, and there has still been no measurable progress, and that's not good enough. Stalking is a deeply insidious, invasive, psychological form of criminal abuse, with shocking side effects and consequences for the victims. If the targeted victim does not give attention to the stalker, that is likely to escalate into something much more sinister. And as the previous speaker mentioned, 1 in 5 women and 1 in 10 men are likely to be victims at some stage in their life experience. Worryingly, on average, 21 people connected with a victim will also be impacted as secondary victims of this crime. Stalking is a breach of human rights, and therefore it undermines Article 8 of the Human Rights Act. Yet here in the North, it's not a specific criminal offence. Stalking complaints are currently addressed within the framework of the Protection of Harassment Order. However, in England and Wales, because the Protection of Harassment Act did not effectively deal with stalking, that Act was amended, and two stalking offences have since been introduced in 2012. More significantly, Scottish law since 2010 has made stalking a specific criminal offence. Scottish law has made stalking a priority crime, and we should follow Scotland's lead, in my view. We require effective legislation, but prosecution and conviction rates will also depend upon the training to change attitudes towards stalking itself, improve investigation, and to secure robust prosecutions. In parallel, there needs to be a concentrated focus upon digital stalking, cybercrime, and online abuse. Stalking has been a crime which has existed for much too long beyond the reach of effective law in Ireland, North and South. And in that context, Elias Concordia, this gap in our law should be closed by the Department of Justice, and I would commend the Minister to take the importance of this debate on board today, and that she should in fact consider how it can be prioritised as an item of all island cooperation in the future. For my gift.
Called Doug Beattie.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker. I suppose a lot of people will think this is quite a soft debate, given what's happened over the summer with a £1 billion property deal linked to one political party and another political party
trying to... Ask the member to address the point in question, please, the debate in question.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I suppose there's a lot happened over the summer that some people will see this as a soft debate, but it is not a soft debate. I think this is a good debate, I think it's a strong debate, and I thank the member for Lagan Valley for bringing this debate to the floor. And I don't want to stand here and just repeat everything what people have said here, because word for word, I agree with every single one of them. And it's important that we show that we have a united assembly here. We already heard there's no legal definition of stalking, but it is clearly linked to intimidation, and it's clearly linked to harassment, and it's unwanted communication, and it's done in a distressing manner, we've already heard. And that can be taken in the form of telephone calls, letters, emails, texts, spending or leaving unsolicited material, graffiti, or messages on social media, where, if looked at in isolation, probably don't look that bad. But when brought in together or done repeatedly, it takes on a far more sinister aspect to it. Unwanted intrusions, including following, waiting for, spying, approaching, accosting, or going to a person's home, in addition to a communications and intrusion, the stalker may engage on a number of associated behaviours, including ordering and cancelling goods, services, making unwanted complaints, or threats, property damage and violence. These all have a major effect on the individual who is the victim, and we must remember that it is a victim. The stalker frequently threatens their victims either directly or indirectly. Examples of indirect threats include sending wreaths or violent images to the victim. Stalkers will often make special written or verbal threats and have been known to threaten violence months or even years in the future, and have indeed followed through on these threats. This is a crime that robs people of their dignity, it robs people of their peace of mind, and it often leaves them in fear of their lives. As mentioned earlier, in December 2015, a Home Office consultation paper, including a stalking protection order, described how stalking can take place within the context of an ongoing pattern of domestic violence and abuse, but that in around half of cases, it seems stalking is taking place where only a very casual acquaintanceship exists between the perpetrator and the victims. So how big is the problem? Again, without reiterating, it's really quite hard because we don't have a definition here, but PSNI statistics reveal that between 2014 and 2015, there were 3,050 recorded incidents of harassment and 540 of intimidation. I've already... Yes?
Member for giving way and for highlighting those stats and those figures, but does he agree with me that whilst harassment covers all sorts of ills and sins and issues, stalking is something completely different?
The member will have an extra minute.
Absolutely, and I totally agree with the member, and I think that's the whole point of the debate. What we're really saying is we take harassment, we take an intimidation, but what we really need is a specific act of stalking. So I totally agree with the member. And we've already heard what it's like in England and Wales, we've had the figures of harassment in those areas there. The average victim is normally stalked about 100 times before they go to the police, 100 times, and only 1% result in any criminal charges. So what is the current legislation? We've heard there is no current legislation, and we have talked in this House previously about harassment, causing another to fear violence, breach of an injunction prohibiting harassment, and a breach of a retaining order may be prosecuted under the Protection for Harassment Northern Ireland Act 1997. And we have been told that we will keep an eye on the rest of GB legislation to see how they progress, but we haven't taken it the next step forward. And 2012, the UK government introduced two offences, stalking and stalking involving fear of violence. And in Scotland, stalking was made an offence in 2010. There is absolutely no reason why stalking does not become a specific offence here in Northern Ireland. So what can be done to help the situation? People in Northern Ireland are entitled to the same protection of their fellow citizens in the rest of the UK. If it is a separate offence in Great Britain, it should be a separate offence here in Northern Ireland. A specific offence of stalking would send a very clear message to those who perpetrate stalking and also to the victims to say that it will not be accepted. And remember as well, the families of those who are being stalked, the children, also suffer from this. The Ulster Unionist Party absolutely agree with the sentiment of this motion.
Ask the member to
and we completely support the SDLP's amendment to this motion. Thank you.
Éire Mar Trevor Lunn. I ask call Trevor Lunn.
Gormay Agat, Brief Lash Tom Corley. Thank you very much, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. We will obviously support the motion here. We'll support the amendment also, although I must say I have far more sympathy with the motion. But it's entirely up to the Minister what way she moves on this once this debate is complete. I'd like to pay tribute to Mrs. Hale straight off, because it's not easy to come here and talk in such a personal way about something that has happened like that. I've had the experience. I would just say well done, Brenda, and thank you for bringing this motion to the House. Because the motion uses words like a hidden crime, insidious, terrifying, psychological harm, serious cases, murder. Now that's not an exaggeration. These things happen. The mystery perhaps is that the PSNI here, and I was on the policing board for 5 years along with Mrs. Hale, don't appear to have specific statistics to highlight the actual extent of stalking in isolation of the overall term harassment. It does seem odd that we, in the 97 Act, which everybody has referred to, there is actually an attempt to define stalking. It's a wee bit like, I mean, I can remember in the last mandate when we tried to define bullying in schools, and such difficulties we had, and particularly around the case of cyberbullying, which, and I believe that a big proportion of what now constitutes stalking in this country is actually to do with cyber stalking, which is so difficult to tie down and to prosecute. But the 97 Act makes an attempt at it almost by giving examples of what this means. It talks about, actually, state stalking is where an individual is fixated and or obsessed with another. It talks about repeated contacts with or attempt to contact a particular victim. It talks about person pursuing a course of conduct in breach of section such and such, which amounts to harassment. And it even gives specific examples of following a person, contacting or attempting to contact a person, publishing a statement relating to or purporting to a person, monitoring the use of a person of the internet, email or any other form of electronic communications. There's a, to my mind, a half-hearted attempt to bring in cyber stalking, but loitering in any place, watching or spying on a person, there's a fair bit there, but I do agree with the thrust of both the motion and the amendment that what's required, if we can come up with it here, is a specific definition of what stalking actually means. And I was struck by what Claire Hannah said, that the Scottish Parliament, not for the first time, Madam Deputy Speaker, have come up with something. Now, I know our legislators have a horror of anything vague, so I wish them luck with this one, but acting in a way which would cause harm or distress, or all the other words you could use, to a reasonable person of reasonable intelligence, I believe that sort of a definition does actually exist in some of our laws already as a catch-all, as Claire said, and it's worth pursuing. So I will look forward to hearing what the Minister has to say about this in due course. I hope she is minded to pursue it, and I hope we can come to a satisfactory outcome in due course to try and put a stop to the sort of experience that the proposer has so graphically explained to us today.
Call Paul Frew.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, new term, apologies. Can I just commend my colleague Brenda Hale for bringing this motion before this House today. Tremendous MLA doing a sterling piece of work for her constituents, and also, of course, as she's alluded to, something that personally affects her and her family, or had. Can also commend Councillor Peter Martin, DUP Councillor, not of this House but of North Down, who has done a tremendous piece of work also with some of the victims of stalking. There's absolutely no doubt about it. This is something that needs to be uncovered. No doubt the Minister will be getting advisers coming to her and saying, Minister, it's okay, we have this covered. This is covered under harassment legislation. And that is the case at the minute. What can I say, Principal Deputy Speaker? It is time this activity was uncovered. It is time that it is put on the statute book in its own right. And if we clump, which we have, but if we clump stalking in with harassment, it means we do not understand the nature and the essence of stalking. We cannot measure the scale of stalking. We cannot fathom the effects of stalking and the effects on the victims and the families of victims of people who have been stalked. And if someone is charged of some offence because they've stalked somebody, it's not because they have stalked somebody. It's for some other offence, which defeats the purpose, which means these people find it acceptable to continue and to carry out their activity. At the minute, stalking, and it grieves me to say this, but at the minute, stalking is the butt of many a joke, and it should not be. I know the Minister's advisers will go to her and they'll say, it's not enforceable, Minister, we can't do this. Well, I say to everyone in this House, the seatbelt law is not enforceable, but it changed people's mindsets and it saved lives. This is exactly the point I make. Every law is enforceable if there's guidance issued, but if we cover it up, if we pretend it's not there, we will never be able to enforce anything. The effects on stalking, of stalking on their victims. Their workplace becomes a prison. Their neighbourhood becomes a prison. Their street becomes a prison. Their home becomes a prison. The very body which contains their soul becomes a prison. And their mind becomes their prison. Their computer is a window of despair and anxiety. Their phone is a window of despair and anxiety. And those people feel that no one is listening to them. There is no law to protect them. The police don't have guidance to support them. And that is clear when you read the stats, when you read the evidence about how long some people are being victims. 18 months. 42% being stalked for more than 24 months. That could simply be because nobody is helping those victims. People are getting away with this crime and no one is helping them. This is not harassment. Harassment is many things, but harassment is two neighbours falling out over a hedge and then one person harassing the other. This is completely different. These people who commit this crime are delusional. They need help. They need sometimes to be removed from society and then treated. How are we going to treat the perpetrators if we don't even acknowledge that they commit crime. We should go much further than just having crimes of stalking. If we had crimes of stalking, we could have registers, we could have disclosure schemes, and we could have the guidance for the police and the prosecutors, and we could have guidance and support for the victims. That is what we need to do in this place.
The member's time is up. I call Ms. Michaela Boyle.
I rise to support the motion and the amendment and to thank the proposer of the motion for bringing it to the House. Much has been said about the current legislation on stalking and the new legislation in England and Wales, where stalking was made an offence in 2012, where new offences have been introduced there. However, if we are to introduce new legislation here, we have to look at lessons learned from legislation in England and Wales. Even with the new laws in England and Wales, there is much evidence that the Crown Prosecution should be doing more, and indeed the police service, to protect victims, as evidence presented through the court in terms of court cases show that victims are still at risk of violence from the stalker. As the police charge the stalker with lesser offences, the stalker then gets away with a lesser penalty, and indeed the stalker remains free to offend again. The courts and the police system, as widely publicised in England and Wales, are failing victims of stalking and harassment, and there's much more that needs to be done, as people who are victims of stalking believe that the police and courts are underusing new laws, as they are not trained in the knowledge of exactly what stalking and the danger and harm it causes to its victims. If there is to be effective legislation here, and I do hope and support that there is, the courts, the police and all those responsible in protecting victims need to be given the right training on exactly how to deal with stalkers and repeat offenders. We need to protect and ensure that those that commit these offences are given the appropriate sentences and that they receive the proper treatment also, so that they don't re-offend. Kent Collier, if you allow me, I, like the proposer of the motion, want to share with the House the words of someone that I know personally that has been the victim of a stalker. Her words: almost every day he was there. He would turn up when I was out shopping for the weekly groceries. He would turn up at the school gate where I was picking up my child. He followed me into the health centre where I had a doctor's appointment. Sitting in church on a Sunday with family, he would sit in the row behind me. I never knew this man until he started following me. At first, I thought I was imagining it all. But then it became apparent that this person deliberately targeted me for reasons unknown to me. He followed me daily, stood outside my house, staring in the window and walking up and down the street outside my home. One day he got quite close to me and spoke. He said that I looked nice and that he liked what I was wearing. I went home, locked the doors in a terrified state. And from that day on, that was the start of my living nightmare. I lived under the fear of this man for almost 14 months before I told anyone, frightened of what he would do to me or my family if he ever was confronted. Eventually he was, when police finally believed me and agreed to covertly watch him stalk me. But it was no easy task at first to convince the police. I was depressed, frightened, and was a shell of my former self. And to this very day, I'm always looking over my shoulder, unable to trust or accept an act of kindness from a stranger. A lot of people out there think that stalking just happens to someone who has a celebrity status, but in reality it can happen to anyone. And I'm thankful that we have the Minister here, and I would also be asking the Minister that there does need to be a robust media awareness campaign on stalking and harassment, and if she would consider that. Stalking and harassment includes behaviour that happens in two or more times, and it is directed at or towards you by another person, which causes you to feel alarmed or distressed or fear of violence that may be used against you. Some advice that I've picked up through research through the Assembly here is one of the things that can make it difficult for police and others to deal with harassment and continuous stalking is the repetitive nature of what may seem like small incidents. Helping the police and courts to see the bigger picture can make it much easier to deal with the offender's behaviour, like keeping a diary of events and knowing what time, date and location when the stalker strikes. And it is a good idea to include all that information, like keeping copies of letters, text messages and cyber.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and I'm pleased to contribute to this debate and to support the motion and the amendment. Everyone has the right to be protected from stalking, no matter what form it occurs in, and have the right to be supported if, and unfortunately for many, when it occurs. The reality is that for many, stalking remains a hidden issue. This is mainly for two issues. Firstly, reporting figures do not reflect the full scale of stalking taking place because much of it goes unseen and unreported. And secondly, as many members have already referred, without a sound definition and understanding, stalking can be downplayed as banter or as something that's just in the victim's imagination. Nowhere are these two issues around the hidden nature of stalking more true than on the online world, as many have referred to this morning. But therefore, it is not only important to talk about stalking in the physical sense, but also importantly in the digital sense as well. Members, especially those from the previous Assembly mandate, will know that for some time I have campaigned and advocated for greater internet safety, especially for our children and young people, in the form of a comprehensive cross-departmental internet strategy. Young people in particular who are most clued into technology are not always aware of the risks of engaging on online activity. And parents, even from my own experience as a mother, it seems are always having to play catch-up when it comes to understanding the new programmes and applications that our children have access to on a daily basis. This means that any debate on stalking must give considerable focus to stalking that takes place online. We know from a survey conducted by Bedford University 5 years ago that online stalking was now more common than physical stalking. In addition, the report found that many stalkers were a complete stranger or a casual acquaintance to the victim. This shows how the nature of stalking online can be different from face-to-face stalking, where more often than not, the stalker is known to the victim. With social networking sites and forums on the internet playing a bigger part of our social lives, there is now more opportunity than ever before to meet and interact digitally. And with people increasingly uploading personal information online, there is a greater chance for that to be misused for contacting an individual with the intention of stalking, intimidating, and abusing that person. Where the stalker is not known to the victim, which is often the case online also, this has been referred to as stranger stalking, and this activity sits outside of the Stopping Domestic and Sexual Violence strategy set out in March this year. Added to this, stalking and particularly online stalking is not a specific offence under the Protection from Harassment Act 1997. And given the advances of social media and technology over the last 2 decades since the Act was introduced, we need to seriously consider, as my colleague Doug Beattie said, whether the current legislation, which is different from GB, is fit for purpose in protecting and safeguarding victims in Northern Ireland. Furthermore, as my party's education spokesperson, I feel more action is needed on educating and informing children and young people on how they can keep themselves safe online. And on this specific issue, how to notice stalking and how they should report it. Stalking is not an isolated matter, and we know there are links between it and sexual abuse and violence, and as such there is need for a joined-up approach. So, for example, the strategy on stopping domestic and sexual violence and abuse in Northern Ireland covers schools on having to teach on sensitive subjects such as child abuse and domestic and sexual abuse. I feel an important extension of this strategy would be to provide teachers with the necessary skills to educate children and young people on online stalking, reporting procedures, and what is inappropriate internet behaviour. As a pressing issue and one that will only grow in the future, we simply cannot sit idly by with legislation that is well past its use by date. I commend this motion to you and the SLP amendment and look forward to the continuing debate. Thank you.
Éireann Pat Sheehan. I call Pat Sheehan.
And I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate, and I'd like to thank the proposers for bringing it to the floor of the Assembly today. I'll be supporting the motion and the amendment. And as has been said by almost every speaker here today, there is no legal definition of stalking, and there's no crime of stalking here in the North. England, Wales and Scotland do have legislation, as we know. Now, stalking takes many forms. It may be someone the victim knows well. In many cases, it's an ex-spouse or partner. It may be a casual acquaintance, or it may be a complete stranger. And the forms, the methods the stalkers use are wide and varied. It may range from actually sending flowers to the victim, following the victim, constant phone calls, emails, texts, and so on. And in many cases also, there are secondary victims. It's not unknown that where a woman is being stalked, that she will find someday the stalker has actually been speaking to her children, unbeknown to the children, what exactly is happening. So, while we have no crime of stalking here, there is, as has been mentioned, the 1997 Protection from Harassment Order, and victims can take out a court injunction against those who are harassing them and claim damages for anxiety and any financial loss that may be incurred. However, and this is the point, harassment and stalking are two completely different animals. And has already been said here today, the conviction rate under the harassment order doesn't reflect the level of stalking that takes place here in society. And the absence of violence doesn't mean that the victim is unaffected. I mean, most victims of stalking undergo severe psychological distress, depression, anxiety, sleep disturbance, paranoia, and even in some cases post-traumatic stress disorder. And while stalking itself may be difficult to find, any legislation could include a list of example behaviours. So if it waddles like a duck and it quacks like a duck, and everybody knows the rest of that. But it's also important, legislation is one weapon against stalking. It's also important that victims know what they can do to try and prevent this. They should keep a log. That's the first thing they should do. The date, the time, the location of when this stalking has taken place. They should keep all correspondence, whether it's cards or letters, or whether it's electronic correspondence, emails, texts, or messages on the social media. They can screenshot any electronic correspondence like that. And they should try to gather evidence, if they can, without endangering themselves or aggravating the stalker. If they can get photos with their phone, for example, or if there's someone with them who can provide witness to what has happened, that's useful too. And what's also important, that what must happen in conjunction with any new legislation, is that the police are given the proper training, because one of the difficulties with stalking is that when incidents are reported, they're treated in isolation and not part of a pattern of behaviour. So training for police is very important. And I'll rest my case there, a free last concorda. Most of the other points have been made. Carmela Mayogat.
Paul, Roy begs, and just to let the member know, if he takes an intervention, he won't, given time constraints, there won't be an extra minute.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Stalking is very debilitating on the individual who is at the end of it. Unsettling, it can be very frightening. It can be a form of terrorism, and it can actually take over their life. They can't have a normal life. They never feel at ease. So it ought to be taken very seriously, and I'm glad that there is unanimity across the chamber today. But why has Northern Ireland legislation fallen so far behind? It's 3 years ago since stalking legislation has been introduced in England and Wales, and indeed in Scotland. And for that matter, England is already consulting on further amendments with their 2015 consultation on stalking protection orders. We clearly need to get up to date and address this issue. Now, typically, stalking might involve an ex-partner who feels spurned for some way, but that's not the only format. And we need to make sure that it is much wider than just domestic violence situation. There are many, many complicated formats that it can take. We've learnt, others have talked about, the stranger stop, or someone who gets fixated. And I agree with my colleague Sandra Overend, the online aspect is an area which makes this very, very intrusive and very, very difficult to manage. And indeed, I've come across a constituent who actually contacted me over the weekend feeling that their life was being threatened again. And in this case, it was actually a spurned ex-partner. So it's the old girlfriend stalking the new girlfriend and hurling lots of abuse at them. Very complicated. Adopting multiple identities online becomes difficult to trace down. But what strikes me about this is that it does need to be taken much more seriously by the police. And to date, the advice has been, change your Facebook settings, and that's been about it. Certainly, I'm gathering information. I intend ensuring that a much better response is required. But this has highlighted to me that we do need much more specific legislation so that there is recognition of the turmoil that this can cause to individuals' lives, even though no violence has had occurred, and even though it's not the ex-partner, it's simply someone whose life is being destroyed by someone who is trying to intimidate them online. I think it's clear that our legislation is not enough. We need greater expertise, and I believe that if we have specific legislation, I have no doubt that the police, the PSNI, will pay more attention to this area. They will have more specialism in this area, and they will be able to give better advice and to approach people when necessary, because that's maybe all that's needed at an early stage, to make them aware that this is a specific criminal offence, and a shot across the bow, hopefully, and that will be the end of it. But where people are persistent and they're ignoring that, clearly people need to be held to account and brought before the courts and address what they've been doing. We need all our citizens to be able to live in peace within their own homes and enjoy their activities online without threat of stalking or abuse in that manner. Thank you.
Paul, Minister Clare Sugden, and the Minister will have 15 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. May I first take this opportunity to welcome members back to the Assembly. I look forward to working with you in this new term and hopefully try and get some work done this mandate. I want to thank the proposers of this motion, which raises serious and concerning issues around the behaviour known as stalking. The motion recognises that incidents of this nature are often hidden and devastating for the victims of such acts. I also note the amendment tabled by the SDLP. Whilst I would be informed to fully commit to the legislation at this stage, I am minded to consider legislation in this area, if necessary, subject to the full legislative process, including consultation. I welcome this opportunity to debate this issue.
The Minister will agree that in any legislation that she refers to, in order to be effective, would have to include the introduction of a stalker's register after the manner of a sex offender's register, that stalking cases should be kept open, and that, given recent experience, it ought to be easier for the women victims of stalking, and this is largely a gender-specific crime, to obtain legal aid.
I thank the member for his intervention, and if he would give me time to get into the depth of my speech, he would see that I am minded to thinking of it in a similar way. So, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I welcome this opportunity to debate this issue in the Chamber, and I look forward to a useful and valuable discussion. I wish to pay tribute to the proposers of the motion for highlighting this behaviour, because it does ruin so many lives. I also welcome the opportunity to outline some of the work that my department is already underway on the subject of stalking and unrelated matters, which I hope the members will find reassuring. Stalking and harassment are particularly insidious crimes, as outlined in the motion. Whilst they're most often committed against women, they can be directed at anyone in our community. And, you know, I really do want to pay thanks to Brenda Hale. You know, I think it's really brave to stand up and show leadership by sharing your experience. And it really has made an impact on me today and how I will take this forward. So, you know, I think you should be commended for doing that. And rightly so, such behaviour is abhorrent. And I'm clear that any incident should be the subject to the full rigour of the law. And if that means strengthening the law to do that, then I think that's something that we should consider here today. The nature of stalking can be obsessive, with offenders going to extreme lengths to contact and monitor their victims using a range of means. Stalking conduct can be prolonged, persistent and intrusive. The actions of a stalker can appear innocuous to outside observers, but are intensely disturbing to the person being stalked and harassed. I have heard first-hand experiences of victims of this behaviour, as well as Ms. Hale, and I really appreciate earlier before the recess, the summer recess, that I did have the opportunity to meet with other victims of stalking, and again hearing their account firsthand makes me realise that we do need to be taking this more seriously. It can take on a number of forms, whether it's stranger stalking or stalking by former or current partners. To me, that almost amounts to some form of domestic abuse. In some cases, stalking behaviour arises from relationships which appear to start from genuine affection but which then turn to obsession. We know that stalking can take place in the context of domestic and sexual violence and abuse. We have reflected this fact under the new government definitions within the Stopping Domestic and Sexual Violence and Abuse Strategy. In my short time as Minister, I have met with a number of individuals, as already said, and I would like to stand with those individuals and organisations and make a commitment here today that in my tenure as Justice Minister, tackling domestic and sexual violence and abuse is a key priority for my next 5 years as your Justice Minister. It will be my failure, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, that in 5 years, if I have not progressed in some ways to tackling domestic and sexual abuse in Northern Ireland, these 5 years will have been in vain. As part of this strategy and in my department's continuing work to tackle domestic and sexual violence and abuse, we are exploring the introduction of a range of measures to protect victims. These include a potential domestic violence disclosure scheme to alert people to previous violent offending, and domestic violence protection notices and orders which allow for immediate protections to be put in place for victims. We are considering a new domestic abuse offence to capture patterns of a coercive and controlling behaviour. We are also working on enhancing the special court listing arrangements in Derry Londonderry in relation to domestic violence cases, building on the pilot scheme that is already happening here. This enhancement will improve support services for victims while also seeking to change the abusive behaviour of perpetrators, and I would like to say more about these initiatives. As members may be aware, a domestic violence protection notice enables police to provide immediate protection for victims for 48 hours and a domestic violence protection order for up to 28 days. These prohibit the perpetrator from entering the home, thereby giving victims protected space to explore the options available to them and make informed decisions regarding their safety. Officials are working with key stakeholders to progress work on the development of appropriate guidance, which will outline the procedures and processes required to manage a phased implementation of the new controls in early 2017. My department sought views through a public consultation on the creation of a specific domestic abuse offence to capture patterns of coercive and controlling behaviour in intimate relationships. We have also sought views on whether a domestic violence disclosure scheme should be introduced in Northern Ireland. Such a scheme would provide a specific framework for disclosing information about an individual's violent and abusive history to a new partner where there are concerns about their safety. Although further work on their shape will be required, I am happy to announce that I intend to introduce both initiatives in Northern Ireland, and I look forward to sharing my proposals with the Justice Committee and my executive colleagues in due course. Analysis of the very informed consultation responses is in train, and naturally I will want to consider the detail and outcome of this prior to engagement with the Justice Committee in the coming months. Work with partners continues with regard to implementation of the domestic homicide reviews in Northern Ireland. Sadly, we have seen very recently the devastating consequences that can arise from domestic violence and abuse, and our thoughts go out to all those families affected by these tragic incidents, sadly, which are still happening this very day. We need to ensure that we learn from each of these incidents and make certain that agencies are responding appropriately to the victims of domestic violence and abuse when it occurs. We must offer appropriate support, resources and interventions in a timely and coordinated manner with an aim of preventing further abuse. To ensure the justice system is successful in tackling domestic and sexual violence and abuse, I have instructed officials to seek out best practice and international developments in this area, and also seek a wide range of views from stakeholders, including the community and voluntary sector. Yeah, sure.
Minister, that you're touching base with all the agencies, can I ask if you are doing any work with housing providers on this issue as well? Because as far as I'm aware, there's absolutely no onus on housing providers to move victims who are being terrorised in their own homes, although we do have provision for harassment and intimidation. Our cultural understanding really limits that to issues of orange and green or political intimidation, but in terms of domestic violence and stalking, there's really no onus on housing providers, so are they included in the agencies?
I thank the member for the intervention, and indeed, as I said, domestic violence and sexual abuse will be something that will be my overarching priorities in the next 5 years. My approach is to consult a number of stakeholders, indeed some of the housing providers, as you have outlined. I think it's important that we have a full social picture of how domestic and violence has an impact on the lives of people in Northern Ireland. So I appreciate that intervention, but it's something I'm minded to do anyway, so thank you. I am committed to making sure the PSNI and other justice partners have the best possible tools to tackle domestic and sexual violence and abuse, and that law provides the best possible protection to victims. I want to ensure that all victims can enjoy a life without fear, including victims of stalking. A number of people have outlined the existing law, and I think it is important that we reiterate it, because it is more than harassment, as some people have suggested. On the 30th of June, the Justice Committee received a briefing from Professor Evan Stark on coercive control and domestic violence. During the discussion, it was noted that, unlike the rest of the United Kingdom, Northern Ireland does not have a specific offence of stalking. The committee subsequently requested details of the legal protection from stalking-type behaviour that currently exists in Northern Ireland, and my department responded on the 22nd of August. Before outlining my views on the need for additional legislation, it is helpful that we remind ourselves of the existing laws which provide protection against harassing and stalking-type behaviours. So currently, as others have already alluded to, the Protection from Harassment Northern Ireland Order 1997, the Malicious Communications Act 1998 and the Communications Act 2003 do provide a range of powers that offer protection against a number of actions which may constitute stalking behaviour. Harassment, putting people in fear of violence, sending offensive messages, threats or obscene material, and causing anxiety by sending a message are all offences covered by the above criminal laws. Although the Protection from Harassment Order does not specifically refer to stalking, it was designed to criminalise many forms of harassment, including conduct which amounts to stalking. The order provides that if a course of conduct is embarked upon by an individual that causes fear or distress to the victim concerned, then that individual is guilty of an offence, if they ought to know such conduct amounted to harassment. A course of conduct is defined as actions taking place on at least two occasions. A person guilty of this offence is liable to up to 2 years imprisonment on conviction and indictment and or an unlimited fine. On summary conviction, the maximum penalty is 6 months imprisonment. The order also created the offence of causing another person to fear violence, again requiring this to have happened on at least two occasions. A person guilty of this offence is liable to up to 7 years imprisonment on conviction and indictment and or an unlimited fine. On summary conviction, the maximum penalty is 6 months imprisonment. The order further enables the victim to seek an injunction or restraining order to prevent the defendant from causing further harassment. Breach of an injunction or a restraining order carries a penalty if convicted on indictment of up to 5 years imprisonment and or an unlimited fine if convicted on indictment and or summary conviction of 6 months imprisonment. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, there are a number of other offences in relation to the above Act, but I'm not going to go through the various punishments for those, because I think I want to come back to the whole point of defining stalking in law. The Justice Act provides provision for making violent offences prevention order. When commenced, hopefully later this autumn, the VOPO as a civil preventative order will be available to help mitigate the risk of violent reoffending from certain individuals and could be used in those extreme cases where a victim of stalking is at risk of serious harm, physical or psychological, from the offender. The police would apply for an order through the courts and it would be for the court to decide whether making an order is necessary. As previous speakers have noticed, specific standalone offences of stalking have been created in Scotland and in England and in Wales. These offences have been in operation in Scotland since 2010 and England and Wales since 2012. Although neither piece of legislation defines stalking in the strict legal sense, but sets out examples of behaviours which may constitute the offence. Maximum penalties for these offences are 5 years imprisonment on conviction of indictment. As Justice Minister, I am keen to ensure that the criminal law in Northern Ireland is fit for purpose and that we learn from experiences from other jurisdictions where they can make a difference for the better. And I have already asked my officials to review the existing laws around stalking here and elsewhere and to report to me on the need for introduction of additional legislation to safeguard victims of stalking in this jurisdiction. Although this work is at an early stage, they have begun to engage with officials in England and Wales and Scotland to identify the impact of these new offences in terms of prosecutions and convictions. I note, however, that the Home Office have concluded a consultation on the introduction of a stalking protection order to supplement their offence and that responses are currently being considered. Proposals to augment a relatively new law might suggest that gaps have been identified on how the stalking offence operates in England and Wales and reinforces the need to ensure that any changes to the law in this area are carefully considered and properly developed. In the meantime, I am keen that we recognise and acknowledge that there is no white card for all those who carry out this appalling behaviour. Stalking is beyond doubt a criminal activity under existing law, and we should take care not to send this message that Northern Ireland is a safe place for stalkers. It isn't. I will turn briefly to the amendment which calls for specific new legislation to enable stalking to be prosecuted based on the stalker's behaviour and the effects of the victim. As I said at the outset, I am reluctant to fully commit to the amendment as specifically worded at this stage. It is quite prescriptive and I would feel that until I am fully informed, I can't make a decision on this matter. But you know, I will commit in saying that if gaps are identified in the work that we're currently doing to see if we can find a space for new legislation in Northern Ireland, that I'm minded to do so. I do, however, wish to assure the whole House that I have listened intently to what has been said in the Chamber and that my officials will be mindful of the arguments that have been made as they continue with their review. And I will keep the Justice Committee and the House informed as the work progresses. I'm therefore happy to support the motion and I hope that members are reassured that as well as a number of initiatives that I have already outlined in relation to domestic and sexual violence and coercive control, my department has already begun to examine the need for new legislation to protect and safeguard victims of stalking in Northern Ireland. Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker.
As question time begins at 2 p.m, I suggest the House take its ease until then. The debate will continue after question time when the next member to speak will be Sinead Bradley, who will be winding on the amendment.
Members, we now return to the debate on stalking. I call Ms Sinead Bradley to wind the amendment, and the member has 5 minutes. Ms Bradley.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Firstly, at the outset, I'd like to place on record my unreserved support for this motion and the amendment. And I further wish to thank the member, Brenda Hale, who brought this perhaps overdue motion in front of the House today. My party colleague, Claire Hannah, along with others, have rightly highlighted the need to ensure that efficient, clear and accessible legislation is put in place to target the increasingly common and serious crime that is stalking. Many across the House highlighted the fact that there is no legal definition, but good attempts and suggestions have been presented today for consideration. Contributions across the House today made for difficult listening at times and very truthful shares of information. Also, researching the topic did throw up uncomfortable reading material and some shocking statistics that have been shared across this House today. Many members rightly referred to reports suggesting that the misuse of social media is perhaps now helping fuel the increasing incidence of stalking. It's true to add that many high-profile cases have given us an insight to the horrors experienced by those subjected to this heinous and often delusional crime. But of course, we are now all aware that that crime, once perceived to be a crime reserved for celebrities and high-profile personalities, no longer conforms to such boundaries. With the Office of National Statistics stating that 1 in 6 women and 1 in 12 men have experienced stalking offences, some argue even that shocking statistic is grossly underestimated. And that's a notion I subscribe to when you consider, and it has already been reported today, that most people are receiving their 100th incident before they actually contact police and report the stalking. So we cannot help but ask the question, how many cases go unreported? Perhaps for now we might just have to accept that we do not have an accurate reading on the true scale of the issue, and while legislation is lacking and stalking has not been given due recognition as a serious crime, those affected by it are more likely to feel disempowered in reporting this crime. There is, however, sufficient evidence in the public domain for this House to recognise and realise the need for early and effective legislation. It was reassuring to listen to the House speak in unison on this motion and the amendment presented. And I welcome the fact that the Minister for Justice was present throughout the debate to hear the overwhelming support that exists in seeing new legislation tabled for this specific crime. The Minister did express full support for the motion, but unfortunately fell short of giving 100% support to the amendment as tabled. I recognise that, but I would ask the Minister to, as this topic is, I suppose, discussed further and the knowledge base deepens, I would ask her to reflect on her position. And I would also ask that she takes her steer on this from those people who are affected by the crime of stalking. The Minister rightly linked the debate on stalking to domestic violence, and the Metropolitan Police Service found that 40% of victims of domestic murder had also been stalked. But legislation on stalking as a specific crime is missing from our statute books. Members across the House rightly pointed out that any legislative framework must reach deep into the roots of the problem and help cultivate a culture that enables those targeted by stalkers to come forward with confidence. Suggestions of the requirements include up-to-date training for police service, the introduction of additional services and support contact points. It will also require the ability for authorities to take swift and immediate action to protect the well-being of those affected. Properly placed restraining orders, the notion of national, international stalker registers, and particularly from those people who are identified as being persistent stalkers. And ultimately, in the case of an alleged stalker being found guilty, sentencing must reflect the harrowing and serious nature of their crime. Likewise, rehabilitation should form a large part of any sentencing. Perpetrators' perceptions of reality need to be broken down, allowing them to see things from the perspective of the targeted person. But of course, the fear of danger does not end there for the person who has been stalked. There will always be that dreaded release date. The stalked person will inevitably fear an aggrieved stalker presenting to seek revenge.
Ask the member to conclude her remarks.
Thank you. Good legislation and failed legislation on stalking has already been introduced in many countries. It is now time we study those and make a Northern Ireland model. Stalking is a cruel, manipulative and appalling crime.
Ask the member to conclude her remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Perpetrators should know that any law will reflect this. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I call Ms. Pam Cameron to wind on the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I rise to support this motion today and to thank my colleague Brenda Hale for bringing this incredibly relevant issue to the House today. I'd also like to declare an interest as the Chair of the All-Party Group on Domestic Violence at this stage. As the only part of the United Kingdom without any specific legislation to deal with stalking, the people of Northern Ireland are left in a vulnerable and exposed position. It is incredibly alarming that people living within our part of the United Kingdom are not afforded the same protection and are at greater risk to perpetrators and their actions than our neighbours in the mainland UK. With the increased use of social media, the opportunities to make a person's life a misery are infinite and easily accessible. Societal changes have meant that the lines of what is acceptable behaviour are often blurred, particularly with the internet and social media. Without legislation, victims are at risk of serious psychological and physical harm, whilst perpetrators are allowed, without
sufficient deterrence to continue and in most cases escalate their behaviour, with so many victims of stalking falling between the cracks in legislation, we are failing to protect victims from serious mental distress, physical injury and, in worst cases, rape and even murder. Most of you will be aware of my work with Women's Aid, and sadly it appears instances of stalking go hand in hand with domestic violence, with one in eight crimes reported to the PSNI being of domestic nature. It is clear that with such a high volume of occurrences, stalking will undoubtedly be involved in many of these cases. It is widely recognised that domestic violence has a huge impact on the economy through the cost of the health service, the justice system, and in providing emergency housing. Women's Aid estimate the cost to be in the region of £180 million per year, a financial burden that Northern Ireland can ill afford. For the financial implications alone, we should be looking to multi-agency and joined-up working to ensure that we're doing all that we can to remove this blight on our society. The introduction of specific stalking legislation would make a small but enormously impactful step to dealing with stalking, particularly in the context of domestic violence. With stalking being such a menacing and underhand offence, victims often do not realise it's happening until it has spiralled to a distressing level. Victims can suffer anything from being watched both physically and virtually to harassment and intimidation. Whilst in England and Wales have recognised the Protection from Harassment Act 1997 was not specific enough to deal with stalking, Northern Ireland has not given the PSNI and the courts the powers to deal effectively with this offence. Under current legislation, stalking is not recognised as specific behaviour and falls short in recognising that serious alarm or distress causes the victim harm. This therefore means the perpetrators are not only prosecuted under a Section 2 summary offence, as no violence has occurred, dealt with at magistrate's court level, and can be free to resume their threatening, intimidating and sinister behaviour within months of release from prison. Given the scope for the problem to grow exponentially with an explosion of social media, we urgently need legislation to protect people from unwanted or unsolicited contact. The changes to the law in England and Wales occurred following a parliamentary inquiry into the efficacy of the Protection from Harassment Act 1997 in dealing with the perpetrators of stalking. The inquiry found that the law was not fit for purpose and changes were made, which reflected changes already made to Scottish law in 2010. I would call on the Minister for Justice to recognise that if a law which was recognised as not fit for to protect victims of stalking in England, Wales and Scotland, it should not be accepted for the people of Northern Ireland. Mr Speaker, just at this point I want to add some comments from the other members in this debate, and I'm very pleased that so many people did take part in a very full debate, and indeed there was support across this chamber for both the motion and for the amendment, and I very much welcome that. The proposer, Brenda Hale, she spoke from her experience with helping constituents who were dealing with this, what it really is, a crime of stalking. And she talked about the fact that there was no legal definition for stalking. She very powerfully quoted a victim of stalking and the horrors of that experience. She talked about the PHA, which was not an effective tool against stalking, and spoke of the department's strategy and the need to include stalking within that strategy. She welcomed the amendment and the support from the SDLP to the DUP motion, and she called on the Minister to deal with the lack of provision to deal effectively with stalking in legislation. Claire Hannah, she proposed the amendment to support and strengthen the motion, she said, and that was very much welcomed. She said that there was a sense of entitlement that some men feel that they have towards some women. And again, she talked about the fact there was no legislation here in Northern Ireland. She mentioned stopping domestic and sexual violence strategy and how it does not deal effectively with the issue of stalking, and she wanted a commitment to address stalking legislation from the Minister. Declan Kearney then spoke, and a couple of his comments were that there was no measurable progress on the subject despite it having been discussed around these chambers since 2012. And he also mentioned that men and women were both impacted with stalking. Doug Beattie spoke, and he described the motion of that may be looked on as a soft debate, but he also clarified by saying that it was not a soft debate. He said that crime is a crime that robs people of their dignity, and how true is that? And he said that there was a need for specific offence for stalking.
He also, I think, was the first to mention that there may be 100 incidents of stalking before reports made to the police. And we know that's even worse than the domestic violence statistics, which I think are over 35 incidents before reported to the police. Trevor Lund spoke and supported both the motion and the amendment. He paid tribute to Mrs Hale for bringing the motion to the chamber. He talked about the policing board not having the statistics to record stalking and compared the difficulty of defining bullying and cyber bullying with the subject of stalking. Paul Frew then spoke next, and he said that stalking could be and sometimes was the butt of many a joke. He referred to the seatbelt law and what is enforceable, and talked about how this saved lives. He also said that work, neighbourhood, streets, homes were becoming prisons for those victims of stalking, and that, again, there was no law to protect these victims. He said that harassment was a completely different subject and that stalkers are often delusional. Michaela Boyle spoke next, and she said that we need to look at the lessons learned in the rest of the UK in bringing stalking legislation, and she also said that the courts needed the right training and the appropriate sentencing was also required. She asked the Minister for a robust media campaign on the subject. And then we had Sandra Overend, who said that the right to be protected and supported by those being stalked was needed. She said that more opportunity than ever before to stalk through social media. She talked at length about the online situation that we do have in this day and age, and that more action was required in educating children on the subject of appropriate internet behaviour, which I thought was a very good point. Pat Sheenan spoke also. He encouraged victims to keep a log and evidence of stalking behaviour, and it also mentioned that proper training needed to be required to, or was required to our police officers as well to deal with the subject. And then Roy Beggs also spoke and talked about the different forms of stalking and what took place. So, Mr. Speaker, that's a quick sum up of a lot of what was mentioned here today. And just in closing, I feel that the mood of the House was very much in favour of making stalking a specific offence under the Protection from Harassment Act in Northern Ireland. And that would, of course, bring us in line with the rest of the United Kingdom, which I would welcome. And as the Chair of the All-Party Group on Domestic Violence, and with my work with Women's Aid, I've had a unique insight into the aftermath and devastation that domestic violence has on victims and on families. We must enforce the message that violence against a partner is simply not acceptable within society. I appreciate that not all incidents of stalking take place within the context of domestic violence, but believe that the introduction of legislation to isolate it as a specific offence will identify some much-needed boundaries and act as a deterrent to aggressive and unacceptable behaviour. I think it is important too that when the 2016 consultation results are published that we look at the recommendations and see how, if any recommendations can be included in a possible stalking protection order for Northern Ireland. And just finally in finishing, I wanted to welcome the comments so far from the Minister and her very public commitment to dealing with both domestic violence and indeed stalking. It's very much welcome, and I think it's very brave of her at the outset to make these bold statements, and I very much look forward to looking to working with her, with the Justice Committee, and seeing this type of legislation come to fruition. So thank you very much, Mr. Yeah, Speaker. Yeah, yeah.
The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it.